Hi, my name's Jeff Jones, director of the Big Blue Band in Mesquite, Texas. A while back, I had a completely original, somewhat borrowed idea to pick up band directors and drive them around in my wife's 2011 Honda Odyssey minivan and have a conversation. This is Maestros and Minivans. Today, our guest is pop culture icon and Grammy Award-winning composer and conductor, the one and only Eric Whitaker.
It's just an honor to have you with us here in the van.
It's an honor to be in this van. Look at this. This is the Maestros and Minivan. This is it. I'm finished after this. I can retire.
Oh, good. See, I'm glad you saw it that way because I was just sort of thinking as we were coming over here, I mean, Grammy Award winner, millions of YouTube. You are a YouTube sensation. I mean, I was thinking what possibly could be next for Eric Whitaker, and then
this is it. This is it right here.
If you'll pause for just a second, you can kind of, you've heard that level of applause before. You can hear that right there. That's just, anyway, we really are glad to have you here and excited to have you in Dallas.
Thank you, man.
Tell us a little bit about, you know, you have kind of a non-traditional background or experience with regards to music making. Is that true?
Yeah, totally. I guess so. Although I have to say, so my basic background, right, is that I grew up, I played trumpet in middle school marching band, and even a little bit in high school, and then I got kicked out of band.
I'm sorry?
For insubordination, or
That doesn't sound very trumpety of you at all.
Right, exactly.
Yeah.
The conductor was a strong personality. I was a strong personality. We didn't really fit. And the entire time that I was playing trumpet, I never really learned to read music. Okay. I had a pretty good ear growing up, and I could play songs on the piano by ear. And so I would just listen to whoever was sitting next to me and play what they were doing. I remember actually auditioning for Chairs, and I would sit outside the room while the guy in front of me was inside, and sometimes I would even play his mistakes, you know, if I heard them wrong through the door.
The good news is, I know you spend some time around the band world, but I want you to be aware, kids are not doing that anymore. That's not a method.
Yeah, I'm sure everybody reads perfectly.
It's beautiful, actually.
By the time I got to college, I thought I was going to be a rock musician.
Well, sure.
And I was playing synthesizers, but also I had kind of developed this whole internal language for music, without learning how to read. And then I got tricked into singing in the choir.
How does one get tricked into singing in the choir?
I wasn't going to do it. I was asked to do it. I wasn't going to do it. And then a friend of mine said there were all these cute girls in the soprano section, and so I joined.
And that makes sense. Now, when you talk about getting to Juilliard, before that, you had experimented with band literature to some degree, too, outside the choral realm. Is that true?
Yeah. So when I was 23, this is my fifth year, I walked past the room where the band was rehearsing. Tom Leslie is the band director there. And I heard it, and it was shaking the walls from the outside. And I went inside. I wish I remembered what they were playing, but whatever it was epic. And since I was in the back of the room, I was back with seven percussionists. And it was just the loudest damn thing I'd ever heard. And it reminded me of rock music. You know, as much as I love choral music never punches you in the gut. You know, like you don't feel, your clothes don't shake when you hear it. And it was moving the air in the room. And I was in love. And there was some passage in there where they were doing, the trombones had a, it wasn't the cacciatore, but it was something like that. And to me, it sounded like the Doppler effect. It sounded like some big machine going by. And so I went up to Tom at the end of rehearsal and said, I don't even think he knew who I was. I said, I've got this idea for a piece and I'd love to write it for you, for the band. He said, great, if you write it for us, we'll play it at this convention. Okay. Right there. So can you imagine? So this is the CBDNA convention, which at the time I had no idea was even a thing. And also I didn't know at all how to compose for band or instruments. I didn't even understand transpositions. And so I just started taking people into practice rooms and, and it's funny because I took the euphonium player in, and this guy, the euphonium player.
On purpose?
on purpose. Yes. The guy in UNLV was amazing, like this spectacular virtuoso euphonium player. And so I just assumed euphoniums could play anything. And then I took the bassoon in there, and the bassoonist was terrible. And so it was like, okay, I'm not writing for that. I'm staying clear of the bassoon. And so this first piece was called Ghost Train.
I think I've heard of it.
And and so it's got this really wicked euphonium part in it that's very difficult. And the bassoon doesn't even play in movements 2 and 3. They just tass it. And the only reason was because I just thought that's what the instruments would do. And Tom, to his credit, he was incredible. He let me make changes even during rehearsal. I'd be running around and writing new things on people's parts or calling things out and sit at the piano. I'd bring back new parts every day. It was like a 3-month lab on how to compose and orchestrate. And then we played it at this CBDNA convention. And little did I know that concert band is that there's no ensemble on earth that is hungrier for new music. And pretty soon people were calling me at my apartment, you know, and saying, where can I get this? It was incredible.
Now, when you talk a lot about the experience at UNLV where you kind of found yourself as a composer, I would say, is that an accurate assessment?
Yeah, absolutely. Okay.
Then what role does Juilliard play in your development? And in what way?
You know, I remember the first week or two that I was there, I was so far in over my head. I don't know how I got in. And
why do you say that?
Just because this story will illustrate it. I was trying to put together a group of people to read through a piece. And I asked somebody, I said, yeah, Julie is this oboist. She's an undergrad oboist. I was asking some friends, said, yeah, she's agreed to play it. Is she any good? And I remember he looked at me, he's like, yeah, of course she's good. And it was this realization that there are spectacular musicians, right? Like there was this level of musicianship that I just simply didn't know existed. That there was almost the baseline at Juilliard. Mm-hmm. And even my wife has this thing, she's a soprano and she sings all this very difficult contemporary music. Super spiky atonal stuff. She sings everything from memory. Mm-hmm. Doesn't matter if it's an hour and a half long, she sings it from memory. I didn't even know that was possible. Do you know what I mean?
Yes, sir.
So the first year at Juilliard was kind of this awakening, like, oh my God, there's just this level that I couldn't have dreamed was out there. Then that being said too, at Juilliard it was, I think I was expecting it to be like Fame, the movie. You know, everybody really creative and standing on tables and dancing and, you know, we're all at Juilliard.
That wasn't it?
No, as it turns out, it was, at least while I was there, it was very much like a finishing school and hyper competitive. And so, but there was a kind of a compression that was happening. And I was told often to stop writing for bands, stop writing for choir, write real music. And my first teacher that kind of beat me up and criticized everything I was doing, made fun of me, and it paralyzed me for the first year as
really?
A composer. Yeah, really badly. And what it did, in the best way, I was old enough by then, I was 25, and I've kind of got a personality anyway that eventually picks myself up and says, I'm not going to take that. It kind of steeled me in a beautiful way that I left Juilliard thinking, this is the music I write. I'm aware that I'm going to get criticized for it, and I don't care. It's what I love. It's what my heart is saying. That's, you know, so that my compass became, when I listen to a piece of music, is it what I love? Is it what I intended? Then that's it. Then everything else is noise.
And the medium doesn't matter. It's just, it's what you love.
The medium doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if it's tonal. It doesn't matter if it's catchy. It doesn't matter if it's popular. It doesn't matter if it's unpopular. Is it what I wanted to write? Am I proud of it? Did I work hard on it? That's it. There's so much noise in academia about the kind of music one ought to write and composers being, you know, like, God forbid you write something tonal or popular. Also for me, a huge aesthetic was writing music that mortals could play.
Okay.
You know, like I love the idea of writing music, not educational music, but music just that people can play that isn't going to be something that only the New York Phil can play.
Okay.
I think there's an aesthetic, and I think it's actually very difficult to write music that can be performed by, like you were saying, you did Equus.
Right.
That a high school band can perform, but that also a professional band can perform and still get, there's artistic merit to it, but then there's also educational merit to it.
What's the secret in your mind in it to be able to do that, other than be Eric Whitaker?
Well, no. I think for me the secret, at least the aesthetic, is that that there's no posturing. I'm constantly trying to write music that I'm not trying to impress anyone. And I mean that on the micro level. So that each part, it's not like, I'm not looking for a trumpet player to pick it up and be like, oh my God, you know, this is, what a composer. More like, is it pragmatic? Does it fit within the rest of the piece? It can be difficult, but that doesn't mean that it's pandering, right?
Okay.
So that it's that it all adds up in an unmannered way. That's what I hope for, at least. That's what I aspire to write.
So what experience what impact did they have on you?
Those guys. It was also the first time that I'd been around composers who were way, way better than me. You know, when I was at UNLV, I was the only composer, the only composition student. And so the only composers I really had to compare myself to were Bach and Mozart and Beethoven, and they're just untouchable, unreachable, right? So, but living composers, I was kind of the only guy doing my thing. And then I met these guys, and, you know, I remember looking at something that Newman had written early on, this piece called OK Feel Good Now, which has been, oh, OK Feel Good. And it's been, I actually convinced him to turn it into a band piece. It was just a little chamber piece. And looking at it and thinking, God, it's just so different and new and fresh and constructed and composed, and there's all these layers happening. And so that was really eye-opening. And we would all get together and just truly geek out on this stuff. You know, that was just the sharing of ideas. And I have to say, we've really kept that up, especially Jonathan, Steve, and I were endlessly writing each other and Skyping. And Steve, had it not been for Steve, I never would have been able to write Deep Field, the original one.
Why?
I was in London. I kind of got lost over in London a little bit. I was traveling so much. I was away from all my friends and my family. The weather is a bummer. And I committed in this, I kind of had almost this manic episode in September saying, oh, I've got this idea for a piece. I'll write it about Deep Field and I'll write it with apps and it's going to be amazing. It'll premiere in May when I'm conducting the Minnesota Orchestra. I called them up and said, put in the program. It's called Deep Field. It's going to be 25 minutes long. They said, great, right? And then, you know, like a month later, I was like, what have I done? What was it, 25 minutes? I don't even know where to begin. And also, it's not a small subject. It's not even like a symphony where it can be whatever it's supposed to be.
Right.
It's Deep Field, right? You're supposed to paint the magnitude of the observable universe. And I was freaking out. I didn't know what to do, where to begin. And Steve and I must have had a dozen Skype sessions where I would play stuff for him, where we would talk about structure, where I would just... and he just so gently guides what I've got, what he's hearing, thoughts that he's got. I'm so grateful. It's dedicated to him. The piece is dedicated to him because of that. But we do that kind of stuff all the time, where we bounce stuff off each other.
Now, do you think it's possible that, you know, between him and Mackie, I mean, I think they let their cats compose a decent amount of the time. Do you have a pet that you're allowing into the compositional process, or is that not?
Yeah, if you follow Steve's Instagram, it's definitely...
I'm just saying.
I wish I had a pet. If I could train a pet to write as well as Steve and Mackie's cats seem to be doing, I would. I wonder if I could rent their cats for a while.
I think that's probably doable.
Yeah, I'd start farming it out.
You're a family man, you're married, you have a son.
That's right.
How do you balance all that with being the one and only Eric Whitaker?
First, the one and only Eric Whitaker. There's no one like my son and my wife to make sure that I'm not the one and only Eric Whitaker. You know, they take all the piss out. So, and both of them, my son got my wife's gift for singing and ear. And so, you know, I'll be singing around the house, or we play Name That Tune on car rides and stuff, and they're endlessly going after me about how bad my pitch is or how bad my voice is.
Oh, come on, how bad your voice is?
My singing voice, I heard Ned Roram, you know, the American composer, say that the reason composers compose is because they can't sing. And it's so true. I would trade it all for the ability to sing. I just don't have it. But my heart... I've got the soul of a singer, but the voice of I don't know, and it's getting lower every year. You know we're doing what we can. I get them to travel with me as much as I possibly can. I go with them, with my wife, whenever we can. We go on long road trips together. I try to be there as much as I possibly can. Right now, my son's in Little League,
okay.
So I'll schedule. trips around the Little League practices and games so that I can be there. There's really nothing more important for me than my family, and so that's first, and then everything else kind of morphs around it. This is where I am right now, is that I'm starting to see, okay, I'm 46 now, and it's crazy to look at yourself in the mirror or to look at your hands and see, yep, this is the natural progression. I don't feel a sense of dread about it at all. It's just, as I say, it's surreal. It's like, my God, this is really happening. And so because of that, and I don't mean this in a fatalistic way, but I start to see now, if I'm lucky enough to stay alive for the next 20 or 30 years, that I start to see the arc of how this goes. That I know now my son is 10, and I blinked and he was 10 years old. Mm-hmm. How old are your kids?
I've got 9, 7, and 5.
Yes, you know, right? Yeah. Like, it's unreal how fast that happens. And so now, say 10 years from now, 56, that's not an abstraction anymore at all. That's right. Actually just around the corner. And so I'm realizing, yeah, I want to spend that time well. And one of the things I want to do is just compose more, is to write more music, go back to being the composer.
So how do you structure your next 20 years in a way where the legacy is what you want it to look like?
Well, so it's a nice way of asking it. So I don't think at all about the legacy. It's not about what am I leaving. It's more just like, what am I doing with my days, right? How am I going to spend those days? And this has been the hardest thing for me to learn, and I'm still learning it, which is how to say no. Because I don't know if you're like this, but I'm just endlessly fascinated and curious. It doesn't matter about what. I mean, start with music. I love bands, choirs, orchestras. I love pop music. I love film music. I love opera. I love musical theater. I'd love to be involved in all of that somehow. I love to conduct. I don't know if I'm any good at it, but people keep inviting me to do it, so I love to do that. But then I love astronomy. I love science in general, physics. I love mathematics. I love social sciences. I love politics. I love, you know, so.
Photography,
yeah. Food, I love food. I want to learn to cook. There just aren't enough hours in the day, you know, and so it's, I'm starting to realize, okay, I've just got to start saying no. Sometimes these amazing projects come through that we just have to say no to, where it's like, okay, there just aren't enough hours in the day. And then, of course, I totally regret those when I'm in the midst of trying to write something, when I'm pulling my hair out and thinking, this sucks, you know? But I'm always glad at the end of it when I've actually made the thing.
So you do get stuck from time to time?
Oh, yeah, oh my
God. It's not a constant fountain?
No, in fact, I think the definition of composing is writer's block and how you adapt out of it. Are you a composer also?
No.
Do you arrange at all? Do you compose?
No, I'm actually not any good at anything.
Well, I'll tell you what, I'll bet you there are some parallels even with conducting, right? Where you've got something where you're working with your students on a moment or a piece, and you just can't crack it, right? And you're I was going to say you're pulling your hair out, but you're...
It's too late.
Yeah, too late.
It's too late.
You can't solve it, right? And that's very similar to writer's block. You know that you can, that there's something on the other side. And you try everything you can think of, I'm assuming. You ask colleagues, you read books, you go on the internet, you try to, but nothing seems to work. It's like you can't find your way around that. And ultimately, it's the slight adaptation that fixes it, right? You realize one day, oh my God, but the struggle to get there, for me, that's all of composing, is basically you set up a box. Here are the parameters with which I'm gonna try to compose in. And then endless invention at the micro, at the macro level, until finally until the deadline comes, and then you throw it away. That's composing.
You talked about your first year at Juilliard being a difficult time. What changed to break through?
So the second year that I was there, I studied with a man named John Corleano, who's probably well known to band people as well. And John changed everything for me. Every composition lesson I'd had up until then was really me bringing in things that I'd been working on during the week. And David Diamond especially had a red pen. He would mark it up with a red pen. And I just always found that so aggressive. And also, you know, you bring something in, it's from your heart. And so when somebody is criticizing the thing you've been working on, it's very difficult to see the forest for the trees. And John, I brought in a piece, and he said, no, 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 we're not going to do that. We're going to, let's sit down and look at some stuff. So he brought out his scores. He brought out some Prokofiev, some Bartok. We just listened to the music, and he would point things out. He'd say, did you notice what he's doing here? And look over here. You see that? Or on his works. You see, now the reason I did this is because this is related to this. This is the best lessons I've ever had. It was so good. He just opened my eyes every rehearsal. And then he also introduced me to this technique, which I still use, which is, I call it emotional architecture, which is basically drawing the piece the way you want the audience to experience before you write a note of music.
Okay.
So just the shapes and the colors, and you even write, you know, this part, terrifying or thrilling, or in this moment you might say, like that bit I love in Debussy or whatever. Just get like a shape out, a structure, mm-hmm. and it frees you from the tyranny of detail. You're not worried about note. You're just thinking large structures and how to build that thing. That's been so helpful, and I do that for most pieces that I compose now.
So when you start with a parameter, you know, you've talked a little about your process being pen and paper and building that emotional structure. Where do you feel like you compose the best, or where do you enjoy composing? In a perfect world, obviously you're in a plane in a hotel room a lot of the time, but in a perfect world.
Oh, you mean an actual space?
Yeah, like what does that look like for you?
You know, this is one of the reasons I haven't been composing very well, is because I've been traveling so much that I thought that I could do that, mm-hmm. I could compose anywhere. You know, okay, so you take a little MIDI keyboard and pencil and paper, and you just need the stuff to check some notes and write the rest in your head. It doesn't work, actually. What I need is a space that I can go to that isn't going to change, that I walk in there and it's the same as it was yesterday. And so now we've got the guest bedroom in the house basically is set up with just a little equipment, and we finally got the piano there back in the house because it was in storage while we were in London. And now it's starting to happen again. The music's just starting. So it needs to be kind of a quiet, safe place. I wouldn't have said that 10 years ago, but now I realize that's true.
Who sees the music first? After you get a draft done, can you share it with your wife right away, or is there somebody that has to see it first?
Yeah, unfortunately for my wife, she sees it during the whole process. I'll play something for her. She, what do you think of this? What do you think of this? And she's always got a very critical viewpoint. I mean that in the best way. She'll never just say, "Oh, it sounds terrific. Good, keep going that way." She'll really tell me what she thinks. And so she's the first person. Okay. Steve oftentimes is in there. And then I've got a great editor, a woman named Rosie Moore, and she's English. And so I'll send to her, and she won't ever give feedback about, well, this part doesn't make any sense, but she'll give lots and lots of interesting comments about, it's interesting that you've only got this instrument playing here, but then the rest of them are doing this, and have you considered, you know, just some feedback that way. It's really nice to have her. Sometimes I wish she'd actually say, have you reconsidered writing this whole section here, because this isn't working at all. She's too polite though to do that.
Well, you talk about the band director at UNLV, you talk about the choir director at UNLV kind of fostering your love or helping you discover all of that. What would you say to educators at any and every level about the composer that might be in their midst that they're not even aware of?
If they're anything like me, and I imagine most composers are, it's very, very few people who can write in a vacuum. And what I mean by that is who are going to sit down at the piano, write a whole choral or band score, finish the whole thing, and bring it to you. Like, yep, here's the parts, everything. Would you read through this?
Right.
Right? There's very few people that, and those actually are the people you don't have to worry about. Right? Those are the people that have all this self-discipline and self-starters, and they're going to be just fine. Really, what a composer needs more than anything is a deadline.
Okay.
They need a deadline. They need to know that on May 13th, there is going to be a whole bunch of people on stage with music in front of them, and I have to give them something. Whether it's good or not, whether I'm a good composer or not, I have to finish. And so the best thing I think a conductor could do would be to really take a chance. If you even see just a spark of possibility from them, you say to them, look, I need a 2-minute piece for the spring concert. We are going to play it. I'm putting your name in the program, and we need parts by this date so that we can rehearse it.
Okay.
And you're gonna be able to make some changes while you're in there, but it's happening. You're now And you get them to agree to it. Do you agree to it? Yep, good, it's happening. And then what I would also do is do what I did with when I first started composing choral music, which is then say to them, listen, at the end of all of it, I'm gonna buy you lunch. I'll tell this student composer, I'm gonna take you out to lunch and we're gonna call it a commission. Nobody needs to know how much money actually has changed hands, but now not only do you have a piece of music, but it's been commissioned. And you're now a commissioned composer.
Smart.
And you know, not only is it a nice thing to show people and it helps kind of create a momentum, but it, you know, the composer just sit a little taller. And then they go into their next piece with a little more confidence.
Smart. What would you say to conductors as you hear and see other people do your music and work your music? What is it that creates a satisfying performance to you? Or what do you want them to be aware of with regards to your literature?
Well, when it comes to choral music, it's all about the text. I'm always amazed at how some choral composers don't really take time with the singers and with themselves with studying the poetry. For me, the music all is an extension of the poem. So if you don't really know what the poem is about or what it is trying to do, the music will just fall flat. The other thing generally is a lot of times, especially with band music, the conductors are very, very concerned with precision. That's a huge thing, especially here in Texas, right? It's like the bands need to be precise. You know, okay, all the notes are there, all the rhythms are there, but it just is lifeless. And I would much rather have a kind of raw, wild performance with a whole bunch of mistakes in it, where it's actually meaning something, communicating something, you know, reaching out and grabbing the audience by the lapels and saying, woohoo, let's do this thing, than this kind of perfectly performed piece. Because it's just, now the ideal, of course, is both.
Sure.
But it's got to have a sense of more than just let's play this right. So what are we doing here? Where's the humanity in the piece?
So a passion and a personality.
Yeah, and whatever the piece is, right? So some pieces aren't passionate at all. Some pieces are the opposite of that. But so I think the conductor's job is to identify that and lead the group into that. And I think for some conductors, they've got to get really uncomfortable, right? Like they're going to have to go to places emotionally that they don't like to go.
Hmm.
But and so that's part of their growth as well. And so hopefully they even choose literature that makes them uncomfortable that way.
So a vulnerability for everybody.
A vulnerability. Involved. That's the perfect word, to be vulnerable. Yeah, that's the whole thing.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I'll sit a little taller now.
And also the conductors, I now know conductors just have to know the score inside and out. Mm. You can really tell the difference when somebody knows it, you know, like truly knows it.
Right.
And I, especially now that I've conducted other composers' music, I know the difference.
How do you know, when you're looking to conduct somebody else's music, what are you looking for in their music to say this is worthy of the time of the musicians?
There's two things. One, either just the piece knocks me out, like to talk about Jonathan Newman again. I did this concert, this Proms concert last August with the Royal Philharmonic, and I opened with his orchestral version of Blow It Up, Start Again.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason is because the first time I heard it, it blew my mind. I just thought, what a way to start a concert. What, it's so American and visceral and alive and fresh. So then, okay, that's, I'm doing it, right? So that's the first. Then the second one is, what is gonna make me grow as a conductor?
Mm-hmm.
What can I throw myself into that is not gonna be that easy for me, that's gonna pose some real challenges, and so I try to have a nice balance of those two things.
Okay. And then, you know, I don't know, I knew it was in the writer, but I don't know if we're allowed to talk about it, about, I'm sorry, you call this Godzilla, I mean, it looks like a crocodile to me, but you're saying that this, you always travel with that.
Look at this. That's amazing, man, and with the animal crackers.
I'm not sure, but they said we had to have original animal crackers, so there they are. Is there something
is
there
amazing.
That's important, or is it you just enjoy?
I didn't see this.
You enjoy a good animal cracker?
So it's the story about Godzilla. The reason it was written, well, it's twofold. One, I went into a composition jury.
Yes.
So imagine this is with, it was in my first year, and so David Diamond, John Corleano, Milton Babbitt, you know, like these legends were in the composition jury. They basically told me that I needed to write more serious music. Okay, so that frames it. I have this infantile response to authority anyway, and so it's like, okay.
Okay.
And Tom Leslie had asked me to write another piece for Vegas.
Okay.
But I just spent 7 years there, and I kind of had it with Vegas. But I agreed I wanted to write a piece for him in the band.
Sure, sure.
And then we were... My wife would get these animal crackers for me. These are good.
They're the original, as you can see, yeah, from the packaging. Were three different options for original animal crackers.
But you got the right one.
We've got these. Okay,
so she'd buy the little boxes, you know, that look like train cars.
Yes.
And she'd give them to me every morning for breakfast while we were dating. And so I started this morality, you know, like I would have them walking around the cereal bowl. Right, and then everyone would follow, into the milk, and I'd eat them.
And this was before you had children?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, I'm just making sure I understand where we're at, and framing
then
this.
And then it started to evolve, and so pretty soon, you know, it was like, and then I would be, you know, and all this. And then as I was sitting at the kitchen table, you know, she'd laugh sometimes, and sometimes she'd roll her eyes. And so I started scoring, you know, and it all came together, and I thought, oh, Godzilla Eats Las Vegas, that's going to be a piece. And that was the real inspiration for it, that friggin' piece. You should have seen the looks on their faces when I presented that as my jury piece.
As your more serious literature.
Yeah.
Just to be clear.
Just shaking heads, like, oh, come on.
I have a wig in the back here.
That's a good idea. Have you ever worn a wig? I mean, not for real, but for fun?
Only on the weekends. Only on the weekends.
When the dress is back from the dry cleaners?
How do you know about that? Did Steve tell you about that?
I have the internet too, you know.
Inappropriate.
Oh, look at that. That'll actually look good on you.
Thank you. That's kind of why I picked it. So I think, do you think this works?
Actually, I got to say, man, it kind of works for you.
Thank you. I mean, I feel like the problem for me is the bangs. I don't know if I can,
yeah, but
if I can
make... I'll tell you what. When's the last time you were able to conduct with a whole bunch of hair on your head?
That would have been never, pretty much.
Never.
Yeah.
Okay. The moment you conduct like this...
With bangs?
Yeah, it changes everything.
Everything.
I will say it's half the fun of having this hair is being able to do all of that.
This. So yeah. That is part of it.
Yeah, you've got to do a concert like this, man.
What if you ever give it one? Is that... Was that close?
The funny thing is you don't even need your hands. So you don't. When you've got hair like that, you can just conduct with your head. Okay. It's so mesmerizing. Yeah. You'll fix all kinds of tuning issues just with the bangs alone.
Oh, well, I'm wearing it. If the bangs fix tuning, I've got it. I'm wearing the wig. I can't thank you enough for taking the time to be on Maestros and Minivans. It's an honor to have you in the van.
It's my pleasure, man.
And we have to have you back sometime really soon.
I would love to. When am I coming back to Dallas? I know there's something happening sometime soon, so I'll let you know for sure.
I'm going to take that as not ambiguous at all, and we're going to call it a date.
All right, man.
Thanks again.
Thank you, bud.
Now, this is great information, and we're honored to have you here. I really appreciate you doing it. But I think at this point, honestly, the burning question that people want to know that they haven't got an answer to, is it a two-in-one product, or is there a shampoo and a conditioner?
I will never tell. I will never tell. Sometimes I even brush it, you know?
Really?
Yeah.
Wow. What is the superior product, brush or comb?
I'm not giving away that secret either.